Well, Cradle to Cradle is obviously in a build on the idea of cradle to grave. So since we were talking at the time mostly about industrial systems as being cradle to grave, and then people were doing a life cycle assessment and looking at what happens when cradle to grave. So a life cycle would say you end up in a landfill grave or an incinerator, a crematorium. So this human projection of cradle to grave, and that it's about life and products and things like that. We were looking at this and saying, wait a minute, what if waste equals food? What if we don't talk about end of life for design, but we talk about end of use? Because if you say end of life, and you say, okay, I've designed it and it goes somewhere and that's that. If you say design for end of use, then you realize this is a utile thing, and that humans, this is a concept known as usufruct, by the way, for those who love words. And usufruct is the word means that humans look at the world as being here for our use, to think for our use. And so if we have that mental model about certain things, then these things are for our use. Why would I say end of life of a thing I want to use? So that's what happened. We said cradle to cradle is really things that go back to soil and water and healthy ecosystems, and things that can go back to industry ad infinitum. So that's really it. Cradle to cradle is things designed to go in cycles, be back to biology, back to technology, and not let them contaminate each other. That's your basic protocol. And then we add dimension to that idea by saying there are five steps in design of products. One would be safe and healthy first, because why would you recirculate things that aren't? Mm-hmm. Second, circular economy, realization, reuse, sharing, shared. Third, renewable energy, because it's much richer than just circulating. It's also where the energy comes from, how's it all work? Clean water and good lives. So that's cradle to cradle. Well, you see it happening in pretty much the basic sectors of human engagement. We see it in business, certainly, because businesses probably should remember that job one is don't kill your customers. So that's a good idea. So you'll see certain people realizing that customers want safe and healthy things. And so we've had the pleasure of working with many big companies and small companies alike, working on safe and healthy chemistries. And so there's a lot there. So we see that. But really, it gets to this issue of commerce as the engine of change. So we see commercial actors seeing this as a qualification of their business and an opportunity to communicate and be productively engaged with customers and consumers. And then you also see it in terms of setting standards. I think that's a really important thing, because if we have industrial standards where the businesses and the societies come together, but have standards, then you have regulations. Regulations are really slow because they take a while. Society has to be worried about something first, then they have to explore it, they have to investigate it, they have to sort of work through it, all the issues of it. And the regulations can often take 10 years. I mean, the seatbelt was a pretty straightforward idea, and it took 10 years to make it a law. So, you know, we all knew that a seatbelt was going to help you, and yet it takes 10 years to figure that out. So, you know, I think there's a lot to say about what process we're going to use to get this done, but we see commerce as the fastest, standards as the second fastest, and then regulations as the third. And they're all important. We also see it in the technical area. Shaw Industries, which is now the largest in its sector, number one, flooring company. It had a few of their people said, you know, we've heard this, we've seen this. Why don't we redesign the nylon and PVC carpet into something else based on these principles, and designed it with nylon 6 instead of 6-6 into a backing that was thermoplastic polyolefin instead of PVC, and something that could be shredded and come back to chemical recycling for the caprolactam and physical recycling and thermal recycling for the polyolefin. And then we can have the same materials go into the carpet streams ad infinitum. So you're essentially storing your raw materials on your customers' floors, and the materials are safe. And it was also sometimes focused on performance and durability. And so people were designing things to last a long time so that the damage would be amortized over more years to reduce their ecological footprint on a per annum basis. But when you design the wrong car to last 25 years, with good mileage, you're still perpetuating the internal combustion engine. And maybe you won't have the same cars in 25 years. And so today, it's really become clear that we do have this strange aspect of objects that are quite durable, designed to be ephemera. You don't buy your cell phone thinking you're going to have it for 25 years. So, you know, the notion that we would actually design things for short use cycles, it then predicates that we design for disassembly, we design for reuse, we have systems to take things back and put them back into flow. We ask ourselves is, well, how much pollution were you doing before that? And if it's only a third of it or something, then, okay, now we only have, you know, 600 million more pollution. So if you stop and think, wait a minute, is this being more good or is this being less bad? And so to be efficient, in Peter Drucker's words, the management consultant, is to be, you know, do something the right way. And having been born in Japan and being exposed to Deming and actually meeting him, W. Edwards Deming, who developed total quality management, the idea of statistical significance brought to production and super efficiency is really an important one. But what if you're doing the wrong thing? So if we're polluting the ocean and we do it a third less, we're still polluting the ocean. So then the question is, am I doing the wrong thing the right way? What if I do it perfectly? Well, then maybe I'm perfectly wrong. So what would it mean to do something the right thing first? Then we do it the right way. So that would be effective in Drucker's language. So that's really the question for us. It became, how do we characterize this as eco-effectiveness? Let's do the right thing first, and then let's do it in an efficient way. Taking elements of an automobile and realizing that they're really products as a service, and it's like an engine is a service that provides power. But you've also got things like fuel cells. They're coming, and these fuel cells could last in, you know, for many years. And so we can imagine them in different vehicles. Nobody cares about that black box under the hood, but in that case, it would be supporting hydrogen as a fuel source. So when you look at taking old engine blocks and refurbishing them and sending them back out as original equipment, the idea of reusing the steel and the iron and all the rest of it is really straightforward and very effective and efficient from a production perspective. You can make money on it. You keep your customers, you keep the cars, you keep production and all those things. But you are perpetuating the internal combustion engine for another 25 years. And so if you stop and ask yourselves always during your design work, what is my intention? Where's all this going? You can start to beg that question that way. And then you think, well, okay, if this is something we do in this company in order to stay afloat as a business so that we can transition into clean, healthy mobility with clean, healthy mobility services, power, use of vehicles, use of materials, you know, then it's part of your plan. If it's simply to save money and do something again, it doesn't have that bigger intention. It's missing the fabulous. And that's one of the great things about when the book came out, we started, you know, even, you know, framing these terms and, you know, calling this downcycling instead of recycling. What you look at for us is downcycling is a thing losing its quality. So it's being cycled, but it's going down in quality. So a PET plastic bottle from which you can drink is being downcycled into a flower pot or a park bench on its way to the landfill or incinerator because the quality is being lost. It's being aggregated with other things. It's no longer food grade, et cetera. Then, and maybe it's even contaminated. Sometimes when it's used in fibers and fabrics, even fleeces, they get added dyes and you start adding zippers and you start doing all kinds of other stuff to it that actually reduces its quality. It can't be recycled again. So that kind of thing. So we could call it recycling, but it's really downcycling. We're losing quality. Recycling would be it comes back as a plastic bottle. But upcycling to us means you're improving its quality. The world's getting better because you just did something. So the thing went up in quality. So in terms of some of the plastics, if we remove a antimony, you know, a catalyst residue that is a contaminant and we purify the product coming back into the systems, even as we look forward to large-scale pyrolysis on plastics so that we can get back to the monomers and start over with the polymerization, we can actually pull out the sludges and use it to purify the material before we put it back into the system. So that's actually an upcycling of the material, isn't that something? We're taking it back, decontaminating it, and then putting it out in a pure form, and hopefully maintaining that purity as we design it into new things, which is the bigger picture. So that's really what this to us is about. Downcycling is losing quality, recycling is doing it again, and upcycling is making it better. Some people have an alternative interpretation of the terminology where they'll say upcycling is changing its use to a higher purpose. So, you know, if you upcycle a package into a useful object, you know, the toy, then you're upcycling that. But if it's the same materials and they're not safe for children, what have you done? Have you made the world better, or have you just done it whatever we were doing before again in another form? AI, I would say, especially since we have the blockchain and we have artificial intelligence, that if we look at artificial intelligence as the high-speed management of statistical significance, and then we ask ourselves, how do we put values into the tool? Because if all it does is take number, it's like we were talking about earlier with efficiency, if all we're doing is number, the less, the more, we're not dealing with our values, the good, the bad, right? So there's a difference between the right and the wrong and the less and the more. But if statistical significance doesn't know what is right, it knows what is less, what is more. And so the question of right is the values question. So I think if we're working in AI, we can start to integrate values into the statistical significance so that we still can have a good, bad switch, not just a less, more switch. Or a 0-1 switch. We can have one, should I do this or not do this switch, you know, kind of thing. That would be really elegant. So that we can start to drive it toward the world we want, not the world that we get as a result of having no plan. And then the other thing I think we'll see in the next 10 years, I'm going after it full speed, and I know the L. MacArthur Foundation is going after it, everybody, is that we've got the plastics in the ocean now. So it's now in our faces. So we've been talking about all these things for years, and now everybody sees it. Climate change is hard to see. It's not so hard to experience right now, but it was hard to see for a long time. Mm. But this plastic's in the ocean. The plastics are in our face. So I think we're going to see in 10 years, I think we can use the tools of artificial intelligence. We can use the blockchain. We can use all kinds of forms of wisdom and intelligence now to go after this full tilt and just respect each other for not knowing what to do, because everybody's making stuff up. And there are things that look like big hobby plans, and they're the things that look like really intelligent little pieces of the puzzle. It's a fantastic moment. So more the merrier, pile on, let's go get this thing done. And I think that will get the fast-moving consumer goods companies, they've got their attention. You know, we definitely have their attention. And, you know, I work with a lot of them. So it's time. That's when we just have to I'll get at.
Yeah.
And in the process, we'll get at these tools and get at these principles and get at these systems.